This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Chapter 1. Refusing to play pluralism and anything goes. Defining the counterculture. In the American popular imagination, the 60s are remembered as a time of widespread political upheaval and social unrest fueled by both fervency and idealism. The torchbearer of these mythologized 60s was an emergent youth culture, actively rebelling against 50s social norms that had seeped into every corner of human activity. Indeed, there were major progressive movements in the 60s, and many of them politically driven and goal-oriented. Martin Luther King Jr., the best-known leader of the civil rights movement of the 50s and 60s, spoke repeatedly about the movement's goal: justice and equality for people of all races and creeds, while guiding campaigns throughout the country to end racist practices in everything from voter registration to interstate bus travel. Similarly, supporters of the anti-war movement of the late 60s and early 70s participated in protests, marches, and acts of civil disobedience specifically aimed at ending the war in Vietnam. Leaders like Tom Hayden, author of the Port Huron Statement of Students for a Democratic Society, SDS, helped to rally thousands of youth, encouraging their participation in politics and eliciting their support for core democratic causes such as freedom of speech. In retrospect, it is possible to outline the putative goals of key political causes like the free speech movement, the anti-war movement, or the civil rights movement, ask what each accomplished, and assess degrees of success or failure. Yet, however politically savvy and directly involved in socio-political movements many young people were at the time, it is a romanticized myth, encouraged by both liberal and conservative histories, that everyone during the 60s was actively seeking to change the world. Equally mythical is the idea that everything during the era was driven by oppositional forces. The work of renowned historian Todd Gitlin reflects a common thread in much politically liberal 60s scholarship, implying that the era as a whole was defined by laudable attempts at progressive social change in the face of a dominant, oppressive system. Many American historians, Howard Zinn, Doug Rossino, Gerald Howard, David Halberstam, to name a few, share Gitlin's historical and political perspective. They considered the 60s to be a formative time in their own lives and history, and they converse, at times nostalgically, about the 60s in relation to the current socio-political climate. As parallels emerge between the Vietnam War and America's current war on an occupation of Iraq, nostalgia leads to liberal laments over our current corporate society, which is compared invidiously to a conscientious 60s that triumphed over social oppression and moral repression. Not surprisingly, conservative interpretations of the 60s provide fuel for contrasting polemical fires. Among the era's prominent critics on the right is columnist George Will, whose diatribes against the evils of hippie radicalism echo the sentiments of former Speaker of the House Newt Gingrich, who in 1994 argued in front of Congress that 60s radicals were taught self-indulgent aristocratic values that catered to the indulgences of an elite few. By crafting an image of the 60s as maniacally radical, and then using the image to denounce current liberal policy and policymakers, Gingrich attempted, among other things, to discredit President Bill Clinton by associating him with the 60s counterculture. Often lost in this mythologizing of the 60s is the decade's complexity. Like any other, it was populated by varied, heterogeneous groups, many of whom had nothing to do with one another, even within the smaller circles of the budding youth culture. Specifically, as this book will show, many elements of what we now refer to as the 60s counterculture have had ascribed to them political and social platforms that they never embraced. Unlike the civil rights movement, for example, large portions of their counterculture were far from being an organized socio-political community. They were not oppositional in orientation, not bound by specific agendas, and not determined to bring about major changes in the system. In fact, many parts of this 60s counterculture were not, as the name implies, counter to anything. Yet these very parts often assume the largest share in our collective memory of the counterculture because they spawned the defining cultural products, the music and the lifestyle, that came to be associated with an entire era. It is with this part of the 60s counterculture that this book is concerned. in particular with a geographical hub in the Haight-Ashbury district of San Francisco. In the chapters that follow, I will seek to untangle this segment of the counterculture from the historical myth that has grown up around it, distinguishing it and its members from the political actors and agents of change, the goal-oriented movements and utopian communities that set out to remake the world around an image of peace and love, or at the very least are so credited. In his seminal 1969 work, The Making of a Counterculture, social critic and historian Theodore Roschick defined counterculture as a culture so radically disaffiliated from the mainstream assumptions of our society that it scarcely looks to many as a culture at all, but takes on the alarming appearance of a barbaric intrusion. As if wary of giving the counterculture no tangible shape at all, Roschick went on to argue that the counterculture could be perceived as a loose grouping of those disaffiliated in any number of ways with mainstream society. This attempt to give the counterculture a defined shape has proven problematic in historical interpretations. And although the understanding of counterculture developed throughout this book doesn't directly oppose Roschick's definition, it does differ from it in several ways. The first main difference is a matter of focus. Following Roschick's notion of a loose grouping, history has made it easy for the 60s counterculture to be associated with different anti-mainstream and anti-establishment threads in various geographical locations, from the 1968 Paris demonstrations and general strike, to Abbie Hoffman and Paul Kressner's Political Youth International Party of Yippies, to the anti-Vietnam War efforts organized by the Students for a Democratic Society, to the so-called hippie lifestyle in San Francisco. Rather than systematically assigning the counterculture label to specific anti-establishment groups, activities, and locations, a task that has already been performed by many historians, this book investigates the development and disintegration of the countercultural sensibility in San Francisco's Haight-Ashbury district. Focusing on the music participants' culture and aesthetics of the late 60s in a specific geographical location and referring to these phenomena collectively as the counterculture is not to imply that the counterculture or elements that might be deemed countercultural activity in areas other than the geographical center of San Francisco's Haight-Ashbury district were inauthentic. Rather, because the burgeoning counterculture of the Haight in late 1965 to 1967 was a nucleus of the countercultural sensibility, it is used here as scaffolding for a study of how the countercultural sensibility coalesced and then became distorted, commercialized, and corrupted as it spread out by the end of the decade. The second main difference is in what cultural evidence will be examined and how it will be analyzed. The sounds and lyrics of the San Francisco counterculture's music, along with other markers of the era, have been left to rot on oldies radio stations as relics of a long-gone liberalism or been disfigured to serve a conservative political agenda. But this book argues that an entirely different set of stories can be heard in those sounds and cultural symbols. The music of San Francisco bands, such as the Grateful Dead, Big Brother and the Holding Company, the Charlatans, Country Joe and the Fish, and Jefferson Airplane, reveals that the countercultural sensibility was pluralistic, not oppositional. It embodied an anything-goes mindset, not an anti-establishment stance. It attracted people who sought, on the whole, to disengage from mainstream society, not to transform it. The countercultural phenomenon in the Haight-Ashbury district rapidly deteriorated in 1967 and was appropriated by other cultural and social forces by the end of the decade. This book will develop and give detail to the growth of the San Francisco counterculture, examine how it perceived itself in relation to the outside world, and what tools it used to define itself, trace the evidence and reasons for the counterculture's deterioration, and show that it was only after the 1967 Summer of Love that history began to define the premises of the countercultural sensibility not as tools of disengagement, but as tools of protest, not pluralistic opportunities but agendas to be followed. This book investigates what happened inside the Haight and out, in its music and its incubating culture, to enable this transformation of the meaning of counterculture in history. One possibility for the transformation is that when a central tenet of the countercultural sensibility, to live without conventional social restrictions, was advertised and popularized across the nation in psychedelic music, it was quickly misinterpreted as a means to protest mainstream repressive values through indulgence. Another possibility is that the countercultural sensibility was co-opted wholesale by mainstream consumer culture and sold back to the public as an anti-establishment ideology. Both of these accounts bear some truth. As we will discover, the non-dialectical aspect of the countercultural sensibility was seething with potential for distortion, exploitation, and violence from the very beginning. The San Francisco counterculture in the Haight-Ashbury district collapsed by the end of the decade because, in part, it falsely believed that it could drop out of the system when, in reality, it relied on and mirrored aspects of the system to sustain itself. The countercultural sensibility, so neatly encapsulated in the lyrics and melodies and riffs of the San Francisco sound, became an ethos of rebellion when it spread on the airwaves to the rest of the country. The remainder of this chapter and the chapters to come present studies of the San Francisco counterculture, using musical and cultural analysis to offer a new approach to understanding the countercultural sensibility as pluralistic rather than oppositional. The intertwining facets and faces of four prominent countercultural identities or personas will be examined: the outlaw, exotic, natural, and new age, while building a picture of the cultural cocoon of the counterculture in the Haight-Ashbury district and moving toward an understanding of the evolution or devolution of the San Francisco counterculture as a whole by the end of the decade. Ultimately, the book's aim is twofold. First, to understand what placing value on pluralism implies about the role of the countercultural sensibility in the American imagination, and second, to develop a detailed portrait of the sociocultural complexities of late 60s America that can be used to address comparable complexities in our own time. To introduce some of the themes, personas, and features of the countercultural lifestyle and sensibility that will be examined throughout this book, let's consider the details of a major cultural event called the Human Bien, which occurred on January 14, 1967, in San Francisco's Golden Gate Park near the Haight-Ashbury district. The estimated 25,000 people in attendance spent an extended afternoon listening to readings by beat poets, speeches by countercultural celebrities, and performances by several local rock bands, including the Grateful Dead, Country Joe and the Fish, and Jefferson Airplane. The phrase human being plays on the notion of human being, a concept that resembled the impetus behind other in events of the era. Like a sit-in, love-in, bed-in, or even laugh-in, organizers asked participants to be in, to be present in the moment, to be involved, to be individual now. But unlike other in-events associated with particular actions or agendas, the Bien asked its participants to simply be. This notion was reinforced by countercultural figures in attendance. Richard Alpert, known as Ram Dass by 1969, would soon articulate his Be Here Now philosophy. And it was here that one of the best-known figures on the outdoor Bien stage, Timothy Leary, who was on his first trip to California, uttered his now-famous mantra, tune in, turn on, drop out. Even more loosely defined than the aim or goalless goal of the Bien was the audience at which the event was aimed. The poster announcing the Bien casts a wide net, incorporating a motley array of images and symbols from the banner announcing the event as powwow, a gathering of the tribes, to a four-fingered claw grasping two lightning bolts, to a central image of a Native American man on a horse, to a list of iconic names written in flared script. Cultural theorist Philip DeLoria has argued that representations of and allusions to Indians, particularly ones as obvious as those connected to the Bien, are often means by which white Americans have their cake and eat it too. Indians signal spiritual and environmental purity. They are anti-modern primitives, yet also fundamentally American. So, for a predominantly white counterculture, Native Americana could easily represent a distinctly non-mainstream, non-modern ideal of original wisdom carried by other cultures. To adopt symbols of those others was to assimilate the other's wisdom into the modern world, lending character and depth to the counterculture. Absent from the poster are any images of high-rise buildings or Ford Thunderbirds, names of government leaders or war heroes, or representations of official society. No one image reveals, in itself, who is and isn't countercultural, yet taken together, they lay claim to a shared sense of nonconformity. The counterculture represented by the Bien appears free of the trappings of mainstream daily existence. Yet at the same time, the counterculture managed to remain contiguous with age-old traditions. This quality of simultaneous disengagement and historical continuity shows itself strongly in the music of the counterculture period, as it did, for example, in the equally groundbreaking work of literary artists in the early 20th century. We can look at how this quality has been theorized before with respect to James Joyce's landmark novel Ulysses. Literary theorist Franco Moretti argues that the main character of Ulysses, Leopold Bloom, is restricted from traditional character development because he is confined to the flow of his inner stream of consciousness. At the same time, however, he is bestowed with openness and variety such that whatever memory, thought, or emotion his imagination can touch is available to his interior world. Because of Bloom's ability, Ulysses, as a whole, accumulates the old and the present, becoming a stylistic melting pot of techniques, forms, and historical references. In a sense, then, Ulysses is like Bloom's being. Instead of a goal toward which the novel is directed, there is just an intense presence in the moment. As Moretti explains, Bloom's character does not, in fact, produce anything in the strict sense, but allows for, instead, an innocent passivity, one that sees the wealth of the Western metropolis as a given for which it bears no responsibility. Moretti's notion of abundant pluralism without responsibility, everything available without allegiance to any one thing, is one that also helps describe and make vivid the sensibility manifested by the various strands of the countercultural lifestyle. It becomes clear from the sundry facets of the outlaw persona examined in Chapter 2, for example, that the counterculture was more interested in detachment from, rather than reform of or revolt against, the mainstream system and its values. In its indirect address to social struggles for equal rights by the residents of the Heights neighboring Black Fillmore District, its indiscriminate use of racially charged musical styles to craft its own appearance of self-sufficiency, and its cunning exploitation of social reference, such as the Black Panthers and Hell's Angels, the counterculture crafted its outlaw individualism out of detachment from any one cause or style. On the Bean poster, detachment from, rather than opposition to, the mainstream system is apparent in the way music is represented. In the hands of the poster's central figure, the Native American rider, is an unplugged electric guitar. At first glance, the combination of images seems contradictory, the instrument exemplifying the progressive drive of modern technology, the seeming antithesis of Native American spirituality and naturalness and environmentalism. Yet the guitar is unplugged and drawn into the Native American fold so that the electric guitar-centered music, the very music that was heard all day in San Francisco's Golden Gate Park on January 14, 1967, is authenticated as the conveyor of past cultural significance. Close examination of the natural persona in Chapter 4 reveals similar paradoxes, exploring the ways in which the counterculture not only failed to exorcise the modern world of technology and materialism, but rather deliberately naturalized it. Indeed, modern technology was crucial to creating the San Francisco counterculture's unique sound and atmosphere. The musical and cultural details of work by the Grateful Dead show the complications of crafting a unique, free, non-mainstream, and non-commercial countercultural identity reliant on commercial and cutting-edge musical technology. Over and over again, the counterculture celebrates its distance from modernity while simultaneously enjoying its benefits. To achieve this distance, we see in the counterculture a repeated ethic of disassociation from people, actions, and value systems perceived as mainstream. For example, the staff at the San Francisco Oracle, the de facto newspaper of the Haight-Ashbury culture from September 1966 through January 1968, claimed no overt political program for itself, but, as its editor Alan Cohen recalls, found a safe retreat in the Haight-Ashbury district and scorned the powers that ruled the world, that were decadent, corrupt, and calcified. In Chapter 3's examination of the exotic persona, we discover how pervasive this disassociation was and how intensely the counterculture attempted to distance itself, in particular, from the dominant American socio-political address to the world through capitalism and neocolonialism. From the music of Jefferson Airplane to the shops lining the streets of the Haight-Ashbury district, the exploration of the otherworldly, from exotic sounds of sitars to hallucinogenic drugs, was one of the counterculture's main means to disassociate from Cold War politics and a system fueled by violence, war, and hatred. The more the mainstream grew to fear otherness, the more the counterculture embraced it. While technocratic society relied on rationality, scientific forms of knowledge and technological innovation, including heinous weapons of mass destruction like napalm and radar-guided missiles, to generate an atomized society, the counterculture shrouded itself in adopted forms of spirituality from esoteric and religious traditions like Chinese astrology, Zen Buddhism, and Sufism. Surprisingly, countercultural voices didn't particularly advocate for actively combating or protesting the mainstream system with its rigid structures and repressive values. On the contrary, in a February 1967 dialogue among four countercultural figures, LSD guru Timothy Leary, philosopher Alan Watts, and beat poets Allen Ginsberg and Gary Snyder, the notion of disengagement was grounded in a negation of anything associated with the mainstream, including social activism. Watts, for instance, was not dismissed out of hand by the other three participants when he argued that nobody can be more emotionally bound and intolerant, and working on the basis of moral violence, than a pacifist. Nor did Watts's examples of such morally violent pacifists, Mario Savio and Gandhi, seem to faze the other participants. Leary, instead, chimed in with support, arguing that such moral pacifist violence fuels mass movements, and I want no part of mass movements. I think this is the error that the leftist activists are making. Certainly, it's not helpful to take these examples as reflective of everything and everyone associated with the counterculture. And needless to say, there are examples of countercultural participants who did take part in mass protests and countercultural musicians who did write songs openly, or even subtly, opposing the Vietnam War and making other political interventions. Buffalo Springfield's For What It's Worth and Country Joe and the Fish's I Feel Like I'm Fixin' to Die Rag, for example, were two songs popular with the counterculture that raised questions about the war relatively early on in its escalation, 1967. What's noteworthy about these examples is that they illustrate trends. Anti-war songs were rare listening fare for the San Francisco counterculture in its formative stages of late 1965 to early 1967. But by the end of 1967, things had begun to change. In May 1968, The Doors' Unknown Soldier hit the charts with Eric Burdon and the Animals' Sky Pilot coming out a month later. The following year, Creedence Clearwater Revival's Fortunate Son and Steppenwolf's Draft Resistor came out. The frequency of anti-war sentiments and songs increased as the decade came to a close, and notably, as the anything-goes sensibility of the counterculture diffused into the larger American culture. Early on, the shapers of the countercultural sensibility went so far as to discredit those they labeled pacifists because of their link, even as opponents, to mainstream politics, illustrating one of the ways that the countercultural sensibility was about appearing to be outside the system. As journalist Jerry Hopkins, in the April 1967 issue of the Underground Haight-Ashbury Leaflet Communication Company, advised, "Why should we trade one establishment for another establishment? Do your thing. Be what you are. If you don't know what you are, find out. Fuck leaders." Perhaps countercultural participants genuinely aim to negate association with the mainstream, to exist outside the system. It's not that people associated with the counterculture were unaware of politics or inequalities or unmoved by the horrors of war. But by refusing allegiance to sociopolitical struggles and showing scorn for traditional political activism aimed at institutional reform within the existing system, the counterculture showed that it didn't want to play the game at all. Many perceived that the only way to avoid playing it was to reject the system in its entirety. Historian Richard King has speculated that the impulse of the counterculture was to promiscuously create a new religion out of nothing or out of everything. At first glance, King's statement seems to contradict itself. A religion or ideology or new culture can't be made of nothing or, alternatively, everything. But perhaps there is a more subtle idea to be drawn from this statement, namely that the counterculture negated its association with any single cultural thread by pursuing pluralism, by adopting everything. In the case of the San Francisco music scene, a key way to develop and promote an image of a unique and detached community distinct from the norm was to embrace multiple and divergent styles and genres. For example, Bill Graham, impresario of the Haight-Ashbury's Fillmore Auditorium, explained, "When we began, we could prepare a bill like a well-rounded meal. Along with the rock headliner, we'd put a side order of blues or jazz on the menu, a B.B. King or Roland Kirk or Howlin' Wolf. Or we'd co-bill the Grateful Dead with Miles Davis. It was a righteous thing to do." Popular music critic Martha Bales lent support to the idea that countercultural music was simultaneously everything and nothing, not minimalist, empty, or ahistorical, but emerging from a countercultural image culled out of disassociation with any one stance. The counterculture was really rooted in the assumptions that the system was rotten, that happiness within it was illusory, that compromise would yield a living death, and that the only hope lay in negation. So while it could be argued that countercultural participants who listened to psychedelic rock music, smoked pot, dropped acid, read non-Western spiritual texts, and had multi-partner sexual relationships thought that mainstream society was their enemy and that they were fighting against repression, it could prove more useful to see such formulations as examples of the multiple ways that history has wrongly forced the all-embracing, anything-goes countercultural sensibility into an oppositional mold. The countercultural notion of rejecting the system has been morphed into narratives of resistance and revolt such that history asks, what did the counterculture accomplish, and then assesses its success or failure. But let's consider a different set of possibilities, that the countercultural sensibility wasn't about changing the world. It was more concerned with negation than opposition, with the moment than with future goals, with disassociation than with alignment or allegiance to socio-political causes. The San Francisco counterculture discovered LSD, in part, because of its popularization by Timothy Leary, an unwavering advocate for the possibility of spiritual growth through LSD. Leary started his League for Spiritual Discovery in 1966. The League was one of several official, group-oriented, psychedelic, sexual, spiritual endeavors Leary forged in the 60s, including his consciousness-raising workshops in Mexico, replete with LSD orgies, and East Indian musicians, his quasi-church named International Federation of Internal Freedom, the 30-member Castalia Foundation at Millbrook, funded by millionaire stockbroker William Hitchcock, and his journal Psychedelic Review. Leary proselytized to youthful audiences, trying to secure their participation in his league and convince them to adopt his life mission. Leary was not the only countercultural figure to fixate on a pluralistic interwoven matrix of drugs, rock music, spiritualism, and sex. Chapter 5 examines how the intersection of sex and unacknowledged sexism, spirituality and non-Western philosophies, dropping out and dropping acid, and unexamined gender roles developed in Haight-Ashbury, and why its promise of pleasure in the now over the prospect of delayed gratification was a signal of the counterculture's impending disintegration. What is seldom mentioned about the matrix of elements in this New Age countercultural identity, and almost never examined, is that the decaying undertow was present in the counterculture from the beginning. Ultimately, the ways in which the concoction of elements comprising the countercultural sensibility played out were never as innocent as history often makes them out to be. One of the most telling illustrations of the visible and hidden qualities of the countercultural lifestyle and sensibility is in the dynamics of the first Monterey Pop Festival. A landmark event in 60s history, the festival took place from June 16th to June 18th, 1967. And in many ways mimicked the kind of concert hall shows that were being put on in Haight-Ashbury. Though the festival attracted an estimated 50,000 people, its setting in the quiet town of Monterey managed to keep much of the mass media away. Several San Francisco organizers and promoters arranged the event, and the Haight-Ashbury's own LSD whiz kid, Augustus Owsley III, handed out hundreds of his special acid tabs, named for the occasion Monterey Purple. The major San Francisco bands, the Grateful Dead, Jefferson Airplane, Quicksilver Messenger Service, and Big Brother and the Holding Company were all there. And psychedelic lighting was provided by Jerry Abrams, one of the men who lit up the San Francisco concert halls. Not everything at the festival, however, was idyllic, unique, and lovingly San Franciscan. The weekend included guitarist Pete Townsend and drummer Keith Moon, of the British band who smashing their instruments to pieces on stage following, ironically, a performance of My Generation. Eric Burdon and the Animals, also British, concluded their set with a foreboding performance of the Rolling Stones' Painted Black. And of course, there was Jimi Hendrix, an American expatriate of sorts, returning from London to make a name for himself in his home country. The Jimi Hendrix Experience was the second to last act to play at the festival and gave one of the most famous rock performances in history, captured for posterity on D.A. Pinnebaker's film Monterey Pop. After humping the amplifier, Hendrix finished the last chorus of Wild Thing and dropped to his knees. As if performing some kind of obscure religious ritual, he put his guitar on the stage, sprayed lighter fluid on it, kissed it goodbye, and ignited it, throwing its burning shards into the audience. Along with the unprecedented guitar immolation, Hendrix's highly stylized sexual antics dazzled audiences and critics alike. By playing his guitar between his legs, as if masturbating, and tonguing the neck as if performing oral sex, Hendrix made crudely explicit a long-standing link between rock and roll and sex. He deliberately manipulated this link by transforming the electric guitar into a high-tech musical, sexual limb. One consequence was that songs like Purple Haze came to embody a unique fusion of LSD, the blues, sex, and theatrical display. Reviewing the Monterey Pop Festival, rock critic Robert Christgau harshly dismissed Hendrix as a psychedelic Uncle Tom, focusing on Hendrix's flamboyant sexual image as a reflection of what his white audience wanted or expected, rather than as something of his own design. Christgau's presumption was that a black man with an integrated band, drummer Mitch Mitchell and bassist Noel Redding were both white, who appealed almost exclusively to a white audience, must embody racist stereotypes of superstud blackness to please the white counterculture. Although Christgau was well enough versed in black musical traditions to realize that many of Hendrix's musical techniques were rooted in the blues, his comments allowed Hendrix no ties to that history. On the contrary, he proved his point by describing Hendrix's act as a consistently vulgar parody of rock theatrics. It would appear that Christgau, conscious or not, was uncomfortable with Hendrix's image and his popularity with the white countercultural audience. Hendrix wasn't dignified like a veteran blues musician. He failed to fit the non-commercial image that the San Francisco bands had. And his vulgar sexual theatrics were threatening because of their marketability and appeal to the masses. Christgau and other white critics seemed compelled to paint a picture of Hendrix as a hypersexual black outsider. But with what objective? With Hendrix as an entertainer of the counterculture, rather than one of its representatives, his commercial appeal and aggressive sexual performance at Monterey Pop wouldn't be taken as reflective of the countercultural sensibility. The counterculture might still be preserved in its unique, detached utopian cocoon. But Christgau was too late. Representatives from the major record labels were scattered throughout the audience and had been courting bands for 3 days behind the scenes. Jefferson Airplane, Country Joe and the Fish, Big Brother and the Holding Company, and eventually, the Grateful Dead willingly signed contracts with major record labels. They would soon advertise the countercultural sensibility in sound to the rest of the country, tempting media attention from beyond the borders of the Haight-Ashbury district. One might be inclined to ask whether the San Francisco counterculture, before Monterey Pop, was successful in its attempt to disengage from the mainstream. But questions of assessment, did it work, are not the most fruitful for examining the counterculture. This book asks a more nuanced question about the fundamental nature of the relationship between the counterculture and the mainstream, with the hope that from it a new understanding of the types of cultural and social dynamics that have abounded since the 60s can emerge. Consumer capitalism, the driving force of technocratic culture, relies on reproduction, mass distribution, materialistic desires, and mass consumption, all of which, it would appear on the surface, were anathema to the image of detached uniqueness that the counterculture sought to shape for itself. The following chapters show how the counterculture, whether intentionally or not, revealed signs of, and indeed relied on, the trappings of capitalist consumer culture underneath its ideological and stylistic dismissal of mainstream materialism and values. The counterculture showed affinity for natural materials, handmade items, non-commercial ideas, and homegrown music and musicians. Countercultural participants bought silver jewelry, handcrafted leather sandals, used Levi's, Hindu texts, LSD, and tantric yoga sessions. Examined together, these items seem to symbolize a rejection of mainstream American values. The problem is that all these associations didn't put enough distance between the counterculture and the technocratic foundation of its home in the heart of one of the most recognized industrialized cities in the world. The counterculture was engaged in consumerism, buying and selling, the main mode of action in a capitalist system. A few cultural historians and critics, including Thomas Frank, David Brooks, Joseph Heath, and Andrew Potter, have asked whether there ever was any tension between the countercultural sensibility and the ideological underpinnings of the capitalist system. The first part of their argument is that because everything, the mainstream sociopolitical movements, the counterculture revolutions, is part of the larger system, everything requires buying into the system and dealing in consumer capitalism. The counterculture was one of many social lifestyles and cultural alternatives within the system and, hence, was as invested in capitalism.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.